Hello, I'm Dr. Connie Webster, Associate Provost for Academic Programs and Professor in the Department of Nursing and Allied Health at the University of the District of Columbia and your host for Health Matters. Our purpose is to assist you in managing your health care by providing you balanced information and resources to help you make knowledgeable choices about your health. On this edition of Health Matters, our topic is Sjogren's syndrome. Sjogren's syndrome is a systemic autoimmune disease that affects the entire body. Today, as many as 4 million Americans are living with this disease, and 9 out of 10 patients are women. Joining me to share more on this important topic is Stephen Taylor, Chief Executive Officer of Sjogren's Syndrome Foundation. Since joining the foundation in 2003, Stephen has focused on making Sjogren's syndrome a household name by increasing awareness among the general public and healthcare professionals. In 2012, the Sjogren's Syndrome Foundation launched their largest awareness initiative ever by setting a new organizational 5-year breakthrough goal to shorten the time to diagnosis for Sjogren's by 50% in 5 years. When the campaign first started, it took an average of 4.7 years to receive a proper diagnosis for Sjogren's. And in 2015, the foundation announced they had reduced this time 3.5 years, well on its way to achieving their goal. Stephen's personal and professional passion to make a difference for all Sjogren's patients comes from his mother being diagnosed with Sjogren's in the late 1990s. Stephen has a bachelor's degree in political science from Boston University and received his executive MBA from Auburn University in May 2013. And I'm also joined by Dr. Asha Lateef Williams, a Sjogren's patient. Asha Lateef is an awareness ambassador for the Sjogren's Syndrome Foundation. After showing her first symptoms around the age of 6, she was 12 years old when a pediatric rheumatologist dismissed the diagnosis, saying that the condition was not seen in children or in Black people. She was finally diagnosed with Sjogren's syndrome decades later. This experience has led her to personal interest and her support of the Sjogren's Syndrome Foundation and their efforts to improve awareness, diagnosis, and treatment of the condition. Dr. Asha earned a PhD in special education from the University of Maryland and focused her studies and her career on issues at the intersection of special education and disability policy, public health, and social welfare. Dr. Asha, Stephen, welcome the two of you to Health Matters.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
I am just so pleased that the two of you took the time to come over and share what I'm sure my guests and my viewers are saying, what in the world is Sjogren's syndrome? And I always enjoy it when I have the expert and a person living to share their views on the disease entity that we're talking about. And for today, given your long history and your focused passion on reducing Sjogren's syndrome diagnosis and Dr. Asha Lateef's experience with living with it, I think we should start the show off by telling our viewers just what Sjogren's syndrome is.
Sure, absolutely. Well, we're honored to be at Health Matters. Your program is a wonderful service.
Thank you.
And we're excited to reach your viewers with information.
Right.
Because the challenge is, as you mentioned in the intro, that 4 million Americans suffer from Sjogren's, but about 2 million of them are yet to be diagnosed.
So we have yet to be diagnosed.
Yeah, so 2 million of the 4 million are out there suffering from the symptoms, but no one's connected the dots yet.
Mm-hmm.
So Sjogren's is an autoimmune disease, as you mentioned. It's in the same family as multiple sclerosis or lupus, which is actually, Sjogren's is more common than both of those diseases.
Right.
Yet the awareness is lacking for the disease.
Right.
So in Sjogren's, the immune system is attacking the moisture-producing glands throughout a throughout a person's body. Mm-hmm. So outward symptoms that patients would recognize first would be lack of production, so tears, dry mm-hmm. eyes, mm-hmm. dry mouth because their saliva glands aren't working, mm-hmm. fatigue because the body's overworking because the immune system's attacking itself, and then joint pain because the joints need moisture to operate as well.
Right.
But internally, the internal organs are affected because your lungs, your liver, your kidneys need moisture as well. Mm-hmm. And there's many, many other symptoms, neuropathy and brain fog that also goes along with the disease. So it affects every possible system and body organ as well.
Right, as do most of these autoimmune diseases. And on our last show, we even had a patient who was impacted with lupus. Mm-hmm. So one other thing before we leave from some of the symptomatology or the symptoms, you mentioned the dry mouth mm-hmm. and the lack of tears.
Yep.
I know probably some of our viewers are saying, oh, I get that all the time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
One thing I think we need to impress is the depth in which
Absolutely.
These symptoms would show. So we're not talking like a side effect from
right.
medications that will go away in a few days,
right.
correct?
Our disease mimics a lot of symptoms that might be seen with side effects, but also with menopause. Since 90% of our patients are women. A lot
mm-hmm.
of the dryness symptoms can be either menopause or be pushed off as menopause. So
mm-hmm.
a doctor might tell a patient they're having premenopause or menopause, when in reality it's actually Sjogren's symptoms.
Mm-hmm.
In regards to the dry eye and dry mouth symptoms specifically, if you're using eye drops more regularly on an everyday basis, your primary care doctor, or if you go to a rheumatologist, but your primary care doctor should know you're using an over-the-counter eye drop.
Right.
So going to CVS and grabbing something doesn't mean you shouldn't tell your doctor that you're using it, because that could be a precursor to a disease affecting the eyes.
Absolutely. And when I was reading your website, I was very struck by one particular terminology,
mm-hmm.
Description, that I would like to share
yeah.
with our viewers, and it said that it feels like sand,
mm-hmm.
a gritty feeling in your eyes.
Exactly.
So it's not just the dryness, but it's
correct.
That.
It's the gritty feeling. Every time you blink, it hurts. You have to put eye drops in just to lubricate the eyelids so that it feels more comfortable throughout
right.
the day.
Right.
In regards to dry mouth, a lot of people don't realize they have dry mouth because they're sipping water or something throughout the day. So they're already putting something in their mouth that makes them feel better.
Right.
Or the eye, they have to put something in deliberately, which makes them feel better. Then they know they have a symptom.
Right.
Dry mouth, you might be drinking coffee or soda or water throughout the day, you don't realize it. But if you had to have advanced tooth decay that
mm-hmm.
came on suddenly, or has been coming on for a number of years and you don't realize it,
yeah.
it's not because of hygiene. That's a major symptom of Sjogren's, that your saliva is not being produced and you don't have a quality saliva helping to remineralize your teeth.
Right, and I'm glad you said that, because I also, another one of the descriptions that I read from the website is feeling like cotton mouth. I
Absolutely.
Mean, extremely, extremely dry,
yes. yep.
to the point sometimes that people can't even talk
right.
or swallow.
Absolutely. I travel with a water bottle at all times.
Okay.
Yeah.
I've had the experience where
it's
like the tongue can stick to the roof of the mouth,
yep.
or it feels like my vocal cords perhaps actually stick together.
Mm-hmm.
I've been at parties where I've ended up with, you know, the cheese and crackers, and it's stuck in my mouth, and I'm just
correct.
Gesturing
oh my
because
goodness.
It's...
You know, I never even thought about that. The problem that one would have
yes.
eating dry food, whether it was crackers or cereal
yes.
or anything
or
like
even,
that.
Or even if you have problems eating, like if you can't eat a cracker without having a sip of something to help
right.
get it down, that means you might have dry mouth, because your saliva glands typically when you're chewing will release saliva, but if you have lack of saliva or
correct.
Saliva glands that aren't working, then you're eating a cracker, it's not helping to moisten that cracker,
exactly.
and it gets stuck and makes glue in your mouth.
Right.
So that's a major sign that you might have a salivary problem.
Right.
But also acidic foods, wine, patients that have dry mouth have very sensitive tongues and mouth,
right.
and so they can't eat those things as well. So dietary mm-hmm. issues and restraints on patients is very, because also without saliva going through your intestinal tract and gastrointestinal tract, you have a real issue with digesting foods as well like that.
And we're going to get back to those nutritional issues,
mm-hmm.
but you're absolutely correct, because many people don't think about it, but digestion actually
mm-hmm.
starts with
it's
the saliva
yes.
when they start to eat.
Yep.
But something else you said, I want you to reiterate,
mm-hmm.
And that had to do with one of the potential other problems for people with the dry mouth, and that's dental.
Dental issues.
So when we think about this, what normally mm-hmm. would get a person into a doctor to complain? Would it be
absolutely
eyes or teeth or what?
Well, the challenge with the teeth is a lot of people go to their dentist and they don't ever get told it could be a systemic issue. So they're told their issues might be hygiene, or maybe it's because they just have soft teeth. Right. And so no one ever tells their primary care doctor about their dental decay. I've never told my primary care doctor till I started working at Sjogren's about my dental decay.
Right.
My mother had dental decay for 15 years. Caps breaking off, fillings falling out, redoing fillings, bad tooth decay. And her dentist never said to her, you might have a disease like diabetes or Sjogren's, both have tooth decay issues. And so she never thought to tell her primary care doctor she had all this tooth decay. Okay. And so a lot of our patients, when they get diagnosed, realize they never told their primary care doctor about their dry mouth or about their tooth decay or about their artificial tear use or their dry eyes, because they think their eye doctor has that under control. They think their dentist has that under control. So they go in as a 40-year-old woman and talk about joint pain. Well, the doctor automatically kind of goes towards osteoarthritis, the beginning of some arthritic terms, or the fatigue. You're possibly a woman, some disparity in the women healthcare arena.
Yes.
There could be just you're overworked, you're stressed out, so you need more rest. When in reality, if they had told them they had tooth decay and joint pain, or horrible tooth decay and fatigue, the doctor would speed up that diagnosis because they typically know those are symptoms of Sjogren's.
Thanks to the Sjogren syndrome.
Right, well, thank you.
Foundation, they would speed up the diagnosis. Yes. And brings me back to you, Dr. Asha Lateef. And that would be now, I know that you started having symptoms very early on, and like at 6 years old.
Yes.
And of course, they thought it didn't happen in African American families, but do you remember any of the issues that your family went through trying to get you appropriately diagnosed, and some of the things that you experienced as you were going through this and trying to get a diagnosis?
Yes, my mother and I got to the point where we referred to it as the world tour. It was sort of our way of connecting with each other and taking a deep breath, you know, when there was another appointment to come, or mostly after an appointment that maybe didn't go well, we'd say, okay, chalk that one up to another one for the world tour. But when I was a very little girl, the thing that sticks out in my mind is going outside and coming back in and hearing, what did you get in? Because I was always covered in some form of a rash. Where were you? What were you touching? Did you get into poison ivy? I grew up in D.C. You know, we played in the alleys. There was no poison ivy. That's not what it was.
Okay.
But it was, you know, just literally just going outside. I have photosensitivity. There are different antibodies that people with Sjogren's can have, and I happen to have the SSA antibody, which goes along with photosensitivity. So I would literally walk outside and red bumps would just start breaking out. And, you know, what a random symptom. Kind of like Steve said, you take your little child to the doctor and say, oh, she breaks out in these rashes. Oh, okay. You know, the doctor's not going to think about something like this huge autoimmune disease.
Right.
By the time I was 12, I was having severe joint pain, but I was taking gymnastics. I was a cheerleader. I was taking ballet.
Okay.
So as Steve said, there were always these things where they could say, oh, well, it must be because of.
Mm-hmm.
And gosh, it wasn't until, I guess, my early 20s. I get very, very sick in my teens, had multiple surgeries, was diagnosed with lupus, and then undifferentiated connective tissue disorder, which was kind of the bucket at the time, and then not lupus was kind of the diagnosis, and back and forth. And then in my 20s, I found a rheumatologist who said, I believe that this is autoimmune. I do not believe that this is lupus, and we're going to keep chasing it. And he drew 8 to 9 vials of blood every 3 months for 2 years. And I remember the night that he called, and he said, and it was like 7:01 p.m.
And you do remember.
I remember. I can tell you exactly where I was in my bedroom when I answered the phone, and he said, we got it. You're SSA positive. It's Sjogren's syndrome. And he sent me for confirmatory testing. I had the lip biopsy, which came back positive. It's a test that they do to test the salivary glands.
Yes.
And that's the thing about the dry mouth can be sort of, this is the brain fog that Steve talked about, sort of misleading, because you think, okay, no saliva. Well, I have saliva, but it's poor quality saliva.
Right.
So I salivate just fine, but because of the poor quality, I have teeth decay. My glands are swollen here and here. So people who know me know when I'm flaring, because I kind of have this chipmunk look. And the same with the dry eyes. It's another test that they do to confirm. And I was right on the border for those. You know, you need, let's say, a 4 out of 10, and I had a 3, and it was kind of like, yeah. Mm-hmm. But putting everything together, and then once we had the SSA and the lip biopsy, it was like, finally.
Confirmation.
Yeah. Yes.
And I don't even need to say this, but I'll say it. It is quite a relief to find out what is causing the right. symptoms to get a diagnosis,
absolutely.
I'm sure. And Stephen, back to you. One of the other things that I noticed and that I was made aware of on your website is that thinking about and talking about risk factors, mm-hmm. one of the major or one of the most critical ones was the fact that there was this familial
sure.
tendency.
Yep.
And I just heard you were talking about your mom.
Mm-hmm.
Was it? Do you know if there's any family member in your history with it?
My mother's brother, my only uncle, was recently diagnosed with a different autoimmune disease, mm-hmm. but he was the first person outside of myself that actually had a confirmed autoimmune diagnosis.
Okay.
So all those conversations over Thanksgiving about this person having this symptom, or at Christmas you say, mm-hmm. well, I remember that Aunt so-and-so had XYZ,
yeah.
But you know, they didn't really talk about those things, and they certainly didn't go to the
right.
doctors.
Right.
And
right.
if they did, their doctors certainly weren't looking for Sjogren syndrome.
Right.
But now that he has been diagnosed, I think the family is taking sort of a collective deep breath, like, okay, we definitely do have autoimmune illness in the family. And his daughter, my cousin, has 2 children, and I am sort of the champion for them.
Absolutely.
From the very beginning, her little boy, every time they would take him outside, they'd bring him back in and his face was red. And
right.
so I'm constantly calling, saying, yeah. did you tell the pediatrician his face is red?
Right.
So.
And autoimmune is run in family. So you'll see a sister with Sjogren's and another sister with lupus, or maybe a grandmother had lupus. Maybe
that's what I wanted
a couple
to hear you say. Yes.
And then you might have Sjogren's. So sometimes it runs in families. The challenge is with chronic illnesses, as you well know, is a lot of the patients don't talk about it.
Right.
So even my mother had Sjogren's, and until
right.
I became the CEO at the foundation, our family really didn't know she had Sjogren's because she didn't really tell a lot of people because it's a chronic illness. There's
right.
no cure. She sometimes can't go to weddings or weekend events because her mm-hmm. fatigue is so bad
yes.
or her joint pain is so bad. And so she doesn't want to tell people she has a disease because then she maybe will never be counted on.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's the story goes across to almost all the patients I ever talked to in my career, is a lot of people keep it quiet. And
mm-hmm.
so that's why the awareness is lacking, because it's not visual. So
mm-hmm.
they don't look sick, but
mm-hmm.
inside their body's attacking themselves. And
Absolutely. So
we encourage patients to share their story so that families can know the story,
mm-hmm.
because generationally that's important for people down the road to know as well.
Right, and I heard a Dr. Asha Lateef mention that her rheumatologist made the diagnosis. Now,
mm-hmm.
is this a person that would normally make this
yeah.
diagnosis? And I also heard, you did confirm, yes. And you also heard you mention some diagnostic tests. Would
sure.
you go?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, typically a person's referred to a rheumatologist for a formal diagnosis, and that
right.
is important. But the challenge of getting referred to a rheumatologist mm-hmm. is based on your primary care, knowing you have all these symptoms
right.
that could be
yes.
something that's rheumatological.
Right.
So by not telling about those artificial tears or the tooth decay, you're not going to get referred fast enough to get a diagnosis. Hence why when I started the foundation, it took over 8 years to get diagnosed with Sjogren's. We're down to, as of November, three and a half years, which is wonderful. We still have a ways to go, but we need patients to share their symptoms.
Yeah. Yes.
And that goes for all. I worked in heart disease for 9 years. I worked in cancer as well before that. Is every disease is so important that you tell one doctor all the symptoms you have so they can track your symptoms over time
right.
and maybe find a diagnosis faster in any disease state.
Right.
And Sjogren's is no different. But sometimes
right.
we think, you know, buying stuff at the pharmacy over the counter,
mm-hmm.
you don't have to tell your doctor. And it's important for them to know that because it could be a precursor.
Right. And
so once you're referred to a rheumatologist, they'll go through a diagnostic workup for Sjogren's.
Right. I'm going to ask you to do it because
yeah.
I heard him mention the lacrimal
yep.
glands, but I really want the viewers to hear that because a lot of people minimize
That's
some
right.
of the things that they're going through, and especially if they have over-the-counter pharmaceuticals
That's right.
yes.
available. So I hope that our viewers are really internalizing some of the things that you're saying, and a light bulb goes off.
That's right.
so that indeed if it's happening to them or if they see it happening to relatives, even young children,
that's right.
they will know what to
and
do.
And that's for every disease, too. Even herbal supplements, everything you buy,
yes.
the doctor should know what's going in your body,
yes.
just so in case it's a precursor to something or they see something else that you don't make your own diagnosis, but the doctor who's went through many years of school can look at all the facts and kind of help speed up a diagnosis. They're trying to do their best, right. but sometimes we as patients forget to tell them the information.
Right.
And so if we can just do that for everything, that would help with all diagnosis.
And what about those diagnostic tests?
Sure.
What?
Well, right now there's no one diagnostic test, although the foundation is supporting and has financially supported biomarker research to come up with some testing
yes.
that could be specific for Sjogren's.
Yeah.
Right now it's a more of a diagnostic criteria. So they're going to look at their, what Asha said, you're going to look at the tear production, how much tears you produce.
Mm-hmm.
Then they're going to look at your saliva production. They're going to look at your SSA and SSB blood work,
mm-hmm.
as well as they might do a lip biopsy where they cut out some salivary glands and do a biopsy similar to cancer. It's a biopsy to see if there's infiltration. That's the most definitive test, but that's only one of the number of tests that you need to have to get a formal diagnosis.
Are these tests covered by insurance?
Yeah, they're pretty much all covered by insurance. They're pretty easy tests, not expensive
okay.
tests, and most of them are in regular blood work. The challenge is most people say, well, when you go to the doctor and you're so sick, don't they do just a regular CBC panel or a regular SSA and SSB is not in there.
Right.
And so, and even RF factor, which they test for, or
right.
ANA factor, they have to be added on. And so the doctor needs to add those on to the test to get diagnosed.
Right.
And you can look at celebrities who have Sjogren's as well as others. They took years to get diagnosed mm-hmm. too. So it's not just, you know, it's everybody having a challenge to get diagnosed with the disease.
I'm sorry, if I may add,
sure.
it may take more than one cycle of testing.
That's right. mm-hmm.
And I say this to people all the time. And my former primary, I love her for the fact that she would say, this is one test, one moment in time.
That's right.
Right.
And when you're chasing an antibody, it's sort of, you know, the proverbial
Absolutely.
Needle in a haystack.
Right.
You're looking for something that isn't always present, isn't
right.
always active. So, you know, my rheumatologist, it was every 3 months for 2 years
mm-hmm.
before he finally caught, or we finally caught the SSA. So if you have those tests that come back negative, but you know that you know that you know that there's something mm-hmm. different.
That's right.
Something has changed in your body, or something has changed in your auntie's body, you know, something has changed in your friend's body.
That's right.
Don't give up. Don't
right.
just say, okay, well, it's negative, so right now I'm SSA negative, but we know that I have Sjogren's.
Okay.
So it's not like all of a sudden we said, oh, okay,
right.
well, you actually don't have it. No, no, no. We know that I have it.
Right.
But if we relied on my last antibody test, we'd be back to the beginning.
And I always tell patients, you know your body best, and for all your viewers, for everything, if you know you're sick, you're sick.
Yes.
And so, and to find a doctor that appreciates that, appreciates
yes.
you knowing you're sick.
Right.
It's huge in that field. And a lot of times with women having this disease, they're sent to
mm-hmm.
psychiatrists or psychologists. Even Venus Williams, professional athlete, tennis player who has Sjogren's, she was referred to a psychologist when she was trying
okay.
to get diagnosed
okay.
Because they thought maybe it was in her mind, some of the symptoms.
Right.
And so she's not alone, and she has the best world-class
yes.
Doctors at her fingertips.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you know something's wrong, stick to your guns because it's something, and don't let them tell you it's because,
Absolutely.
Especially in the women, for the females, is that you're overworked, you're anxious,
mm-hmm.
you're a mom, you're doing too much. There is something wrong if you feel it, and make
right.
sure what Asha did, fight for it. If you don't have family to support you, fight for yourself.
Fight for it.
Yep.
And we could share so much more information and may even have to have you come back
yep.
again for a follow-up.
Absolutely.
But before we close out today, I would like for you to share more about the foundation
sure.
and specifically about how people can help in whatever way.
Sure.
And then I'm going to ask you to close out as a person living with Sjogren's, to close out by giving some words to encourage people that are living, if it's a helpful hint about how they could minimize their symptoms or whatever.
Yeah, I think, you know, in regards to the foundation, we're very committed to research, education, and awareness.
Mm-hmm.
All those important projects are very important to the patients that suffer from Sjogren's, finding new testing, but even more importantly, finding treatments for the disease.
Yes.
We're working in the clinical trial space to get a drug on the market
yes.
for Sjogren's, because there
yes.
isn't one right now. We're very excited about that. We obviously do a lot of fundraising around the country. We offer 65 support groups in the United States to help patients that suffer. On our website, Sjogren's.org, you can find resources and materials. And even if you have one of the symptoms of Sjogren's, we have resources available for
mm-hmm.
your viewers for that as well. So we encourage you to go to Sjogren's.org and learn more. We do have a local area walk happening on June 11th in the D.C. area in Bethesda, Maryland. We'd love to have students and your viewers come out and support it, but to come learn more about Sjogren's. So look at our website for that information as well.
We shall.
Okay.
And we'll post that website.
Great.
And you get to close out by giving a helpful hint.
Wow. The first one, of course, is just to believe in yourself. Mm-hmm. When you know that something is wrong, believe that it's wrong. Don't let other people convince you that that's not the case. And to that point, I would say to keep telling people, be it your doctor, be it someone that you live with, be it a friend, even that history, having somebody who can say, well, you know, you've been complaining about this for 4 months now, that can be invaluable. So believe what's going on with you and tell when you need help.
And if you go to your doctors and you've been sucking on that hard candy,
that's right,
trying to get the saliva,
yes,
going,
right,
and it's not working, mm-hmm, just know that it's not an insignificant point,
that's
and
right,
that you
absolutely
should be
well
talking
said
with someone.
Well,
and I did see your three activities, the walk,
yep,
and a sip.
Yep, sip for
and
the marathon program.
Yes,
yes, absolutely.
Well, this has been very informative, and now we have added to all of our new diagnosis, Sjogren's.
Yes.
I'd like to thank Mr. Stephen Taylor and Dr. Asha Lateef Williams for being my guest on Health Matters. If you want more information about Sjogren's, you may visit the Sjogren Syndrome Foundation website at www.sjogrens.org. And if you'd like more information about the Department of Nursing and Allied Health at the University of the District of Columbia, visit our website at www.udc.edu/nursing. I'm Dr. Connie Webster. Thank you for watching. Please join me next time, and remember, your health matters.